Hello friends, my name is Bintou and welcome or welcome back to my channel for my May reading wrap up where I talk about all the books that I read in the month of May. So I gotta say, May turned out to be a pretty good reading month, especially since April was very meh for me. I had a lot of books that I was just not at all impressed by. I will say for this month, I think I read at least one or two books that are gonna make my top books of the year for sure. I also feel like I got in a good range of books. So far this month I've read one sci-fi, two nonfiction, three mystery thrillers, and then two romances. And then there's like a jumble of Audible stuff that I got at the end that were mostly romance, but they were all audiobooks that were free or free in the Audible catalog if you already have a membership. I'm currently in the middle of what is, I guess, would be a contemporary fiction, and I had DNF'd another contemporary fiction as well. So let's jump into the books that I read. All right, so the first book I want to talk about is Project Hail Mary by Andy Weir. This is the one and only sci-fi that I read, and I had done a poll, and this one was the winner by far. I did go on and read like the other three options in the poll anyway, but it was one that I started with. This book follows a man. He was a science teacher, a middle school science teacher, and all of a sudden he wakes up, he's in space on this spaceship. He doesn't really have any memory of how he got there or what he's doing there. And eventually you learn that he's tasked with basically saving the Earth from this new threat that is threatening to take out the sun. That's about as much of a synopsis that I would be willing to give. I think that going in this book mostly blind is probably the best way to attack it, because all the surprises that he throws at you just make it that much more fun. This book was very, very, very heavy on the science. I personally really enjoyed that, but if you don't like that sort of thing, you can kind of gloss over those details, I suppose. But I feel like they really make the book, and it's obvious that he went through a lot to make sure he got the science right. I've never read anything by him, so I know his other really popular book was made into a movie. I forget the name, but I haven't read it. And at this point, I think I will. Was it The Martian? I think I would pick it up because I really, really enjoyed Project Hail Mary. It was pretty funny. There are going to be one or two moments that kind of bring you close to tears. If you read the book, you probably know the moments that I'm talking about, because those moments are still kind of with me after having read the book a couple weeks ago. The characters were really witty and a lot of fun to follow. The one thing that I would maybe change is the ending. It was a very respectable ending. Like, I respect the route that the author chose to go with the ending. I just personally wish that I would have gotten to know more. And that's just how I am. I like perfectly wrapped up endings, and you don't always get that, particularly with these sci-fi and some of the horror thrillers novels for sure. So that's just kind of my own selfish wish. The audiobook, I want to say, also was absolutely fantastic. I got the audiobook and the ebook, and I read those together, and it was great. This book is definitely going to be one of my favorites for the year, and I would highly recommend it. Next, let's talk about the nonfictions that I read. I read First 2030, and this book basically is kind of like fortune telling. So the author is exploring the trends that he thinks are going to increase and become sort of the norm by the time we get to 2030. It's kind of crazy to think about, because 2030, that's like 10 years from now, and 10 years doesn't seem like long enough for all of this to happen. But when we think back to 10 years ago versus now, a lot has changed technologically, so it like makes sense. It's just kind of hard to wrap your mind around. The most interesting parts in this book to me, and I feel like if you want to get all of the details, you really need to read this book. It was fascinating. For me, the most interesting parts had to do with the shifting consumer power from, say, Western countries like US and in European countries to countries in Africa and Asia, where their populations are going to outnumber the populations in Western countries. And their middle class populations in particular are also on the rise. He also pointed out that a large amount of the purchasing power and wealth lies with the older generation, not necessarily the millennials. If you're a millennial, you probably already know this. That may drive advertisers to focus more on older aging population rather than on the younger population, which don't possess as much purchasing power. And then the other thing he mentions is the rise in automation and self-driving cars, and how that could be really disruptive for people that are seeking jobs that could potentially lift them up into the middle class. The self-driving cars thing, I think, is really, really fascinating. If you remember, The Passengers by John Mars is like one of my favorite books that I read so far this year. And this book actually talks about some of the ethics that would have to be considered when self-driving cars become more prevalent. And I think that book explored that so well. Even though it is science fiction, I think that it really informs where we're headed with self-driving cars. That's why that book was so good. Anyway, if anything, this book was super, super easy to read. I got through it pretty quickly, especially for nonfiction. I think it's pretty speculative. I think there's some things in here that may be far-fetched, but I guess only time will tell. It was still very fascinating. And then I listened to Goodbye Things by Fumio Sasaki. And this is one of those audiobooks that's actually included in your Audible membership. So if you have an Audible membership, you kind of have access to this audiobook for free. And this kind of reads like a memoir. So it's this one man, his journey from like a maximalist to a minimalist. And throughout the book, he's sort of like preaching the benefits of minimalism and how to get started. So he also gives you tips on how to get started getting rid of your material things. And then he talks a lot about the benefits of owning fewer things. This was just a really nice revisit to sort of the, or a nice reminder, refresher on the benefits of minimalism, which I find I like to revisit every once in a while. There's nothing new here. If you've read any book on minimalism, you've kind of heard it all. But like I said, it's like a nice good refresher, particularly from the Japanese perspective, rather than the US authors that I've read books on minimalism by. Next, the mystery thriller horror section. So I finally read Misery by Stephen King. And in my opinion, I think this was probably the most grotesque of the Stephen King novels that I have ever read. Like, there were times where I was literally like cringing with the level of detail of some of the violent acts that occurred in this book. So beware, and I'm not normally very sensitive to that kind of thing. But anyway, main characters, we have Annie Wilkes and Paul Sheldon. Annie Wilkes was a former nurse, and she discovers Paul on the side of the highway. He got into an accident, and so she takes him to her house, and she is sort of nursing him back to health. But she's also a really, really big fan of his book, where one of the main characters is Misery. And she wants him to write a new Misery novel, where he brings Misery back to life because he had killed Misery off in his latest novel. So a lot of the book is spent basically with Annie and Paul in this sort of war. Annie is like manipulating him and she's getting him addicted to drugs, and Paul's like, he wants to escape, of course. The really cool part is that the book does contain excerpts from the novel that Paul is also supposedly writing. It feels very meta. I would say that this is not my favorite King that I've read, but I can totally see why people love this book. It is suspenseful. I wouldn't say it's as suspenseful as some of his other works that I read, but it just explores a really interesting topic, and so for that I'm really glad that I read this book. The next two mystery thrillers were part of Kindle Unlimited series that I have read and just basically continue with. The first one is In Her Tracks by Robert Dugani. This is part of Tracy Crosswhite series, and this is book number 8, I believe. And in this book, basically Tracy returns to work as part of the violent crimes unit in the Seattle Police Department, but she's been replaced by another detective, so she has to take a new position in the cold cases unit. And the book follows two different cases. So one was the abduction of a 5-year-old girl like many decades ago, so that's the cold case that she's working on. And then the other one was the disappearance of a young girl from a jogging park somewhere in North Seattle. I thought this was a great addition to the series. I love all of the books in the Tracy Crosswhite series. It's just as funny and witty and suspenseful as all of the other books in this series, and it was a great addition. Then I read Drown Her Sorrows by Melinda Lay, and Melinda Lay is another one of those Amazon Kindle Unlimited writers that I really love in the mystery thriller genre. And this is book 3 in the Bree Taggart series, and another excellent addition to that series. So the book starts off basically with Bree and Matt, and they're working on a case where this body turns up in the creek. And initially it looks like a suicide, but then they quickly realize that it was in fact a homicide. And they're basically trying to figure out, well, who killed this woman? I think that the twist that was employed towards the ending of this book was really, really good and really well done. I totally did not see it coming. Completely blindsided me. And I went to look at the reviews when I was done, and people were saying the exact same thing. It was really probably my most favorite way that she's written the twist in this entire series. Very fast pace, a lot of action, and just a lot of fun. I really enjoyed this latest addition to the Bree Taggart series. And next, let's get into the two contemporary romances that I have read this month. First one is Shipped. And this is one that I just got the audiobook from my library, so I decided to give it a read. And I'm really glad, I enjoyed this. I think the tagline is like, if you love the Unhoneymooners, you'll really love this. And I love the Unhoneymooners, and I enjoyed this one as well. I think that the Unhoneymooners were still funnier in my opinion, but I can see why the two are paired together. So the story follows Henley and Graham. Henley and Graham both work for the same company, and they are being sent to the Galapagos because they work for a cruise company. and they need to come up with some sort of project so that they can get a promotion. Henley really hates Graham because she thinks that he took credit for something that she came up with, and Graham doesn't know why she hates him. So it's kind of like enemies to lovers in that way. I personally thought it was really very funny. So like sort of the vein of the Unhoneymooners, I really love the way that the author incorporated the Galapagos into the story. And so she actually used real life tourist activities that you can partake in if you ever actually do visit the Galapagos Islands. It was really neat. Like, it makes me want to actually go on that tour to the Galapagos for sure. And then I read The Seat Filler by Soraya Wilson. So this is my second Soraya Wilson novel. I read one by her last year, I believe. And her romances are very like wholesome, cute, and fun. And this pretty much falls right into that category, at least the contemporary ones that I read by her anyway. So Juliet is a seat filler, meaning that she basically sits in empty seats at major Hollywood events so that it looks like there are no empty seats. And while she's doing that, she meets this famous movie star. His name is Noah. And they hit it off, but she like refuses to go out with him, and eventually realizes because she has this like terrible anxiety, and so she can't kiss anyone without having like a full-blown panic attack. So of course he's like, well, let's have lessons. So he offers to help her with that. And the romance develops from there. In both of these, I mean, you have that trope where they get together and then within like the last 20 pages of the book, they break apart and then come back together. I think that's in literally every single romance novel. Correct me if I'm wrong, but literally every single romance I've read plays out exactly that way. I'm kind of over it. But overall, very wholesome romance read, and it's good fun if you have Kindle Unlimited and you're looking for something to pick up. Now let's talk about the contemporary fiction. So right now I'm actually in the middle of the Bad Muslim Discount. And I am about at the 45% mark, so I'm not quite done with it, but I am in fact really enjoying it. I have solely been listening to the audiobook at this point, and it became available from my library. I wasn't sure that I was gonna actually start it, but I figured why not start it first 10 minutes, see if I like it. If not, I can just return it. But I'm really enjoying it. So it's actually two different storylines, and it starts off with this young boy. I believe it's Afghanistan. His whole family is Muslim, and he's recounting the time where Islam really starts to take hold of the Middle East and people become more extreme in their religion, and how his dad was kind of feeling very stuffed there, and so he gets up and moves them to America, specifically San Francisco. And then the other storyline follows a girl who is currently in the Middle East, and she's been suffering like a series of loss in her family, and she also wants to escape and come to America. That's pretty much all I know so far. Something tells me that at some point these two characters are gonna meet and it may become a romance of sort. But what I love about this book is it is hilarious. It doesn't take itself too seriously. The characters and the way that they describe their upbringing is just very reminiscent of my own in a lot of ways, so I'm finding it just absolutely hilarious. I don't think this has been a very well-read book because there aren't that many reviews for it, but it really is quite good.
Okay, so I wanted to hop in because I actually just finished reading The Bad Muslim Discount maybe like an hour ago, and I wanted to provide an update because I think this is going to be one of my favorites of the whole year. This book ended up turning out to be more powerful than I was expecting it to be, and I think that fans of The Kite Runner will really, really love this book. It doesn't really punch you quite as hard as The Kite Runner does, and it is lighter. There's definitely more humor infused in here, but the cover of this book kind of belies how serious it can be at times. And I would say that there's a trigger warning in here for what is basically rape. That being said, I feel like this main character and his struggle with like his family, religion, along with the main female character and her struggles and the secrets that come out from her family, this was just really, really well done.
All right, next let's talk about my Audible romance jumble. That's what I'm calling this section, because this was all of the Audible originers that I have access to, and they pretty much all fall into the romance category. The first one was really interesting in a way. So this is called One of Those Flings, and this is like a graphic audio book take, I guess, by Audible, because it's like a performance, basically. It's not actually narrated like a book. So it's full of music and sound effects. So it's pretty much like a graphic audiobook. It is extremely short. I think this was an hour long, which means that I listened to the whole thing in maybe half an hour, basically. I feel like this is a really cool idea, but I don't feel like it was very well done. I think that unlike a graphic audiobook where it's actually narrated, like there is a narrator describing events that are happening in between like character dialogue, etc. So it's kind of like reading the book. Here, that's not happening. So it's just dialogue and no description of what's happening in between the dialogue. So the whole story just felt totally flat. So it feels like it was basically just resting on its sound effects, which again was cool, but I feel like there was so much more potential for this format from Audible, and I hope that they make it better in the future because I would love to follow up with these. I've loved all of the graphic audiobooks that I've listened to, and I love when audiobooks incorporate sound effects and music and stuff like that. Another audiobook from that Audible section is Heidi's Guide to Four Letter Words. This book is also available on Kindle, but basically the premise of this book is Heidi has a crush on her neighbor, but she's really too shy to talk to him. She has recently lost her job as a kindergarten teacher, so she got a job as a receptionist at this place that records audiobooks for erotic novels. I wonder how accurate it was, because it's actually really neat to get sort of the behind the scenes on how audiobooks are recorded, especially as someone who really loves audiobooks. But anyway, after starting at that job, she takes some of their equipment home and starts a podcast where she basically is trying to gain confidence by reading sex scenes from the books that she has gotten from her job. Overall, I actually enjoyed this. I thought it was a pretty funny and fun contemporary romance read. Of course, it's gonna go follow the exact same trajectory as every single romance novel has followed. And then I read That Second Chance by Megan Quinn. I picked this up because it's part of Kindle Unlimited and it has both the ebook and the audiobook. So I like to find Kindle Unlimited books where both the audio and ebook are available, because that just knocks out two birds with one stone, since I love to read them that way. This was kind of funny. So there were these brothers and they believed that they were cursed by some witch when they went on a trip to New Orleans because they were disrespected her or something. And she basically said that their love was to be doomed. And then this guy, like literally right after that, gets a call that his wife had passed away from like a massive heart attack. So he believes fully in the curse. And this new girl moves to town. She just got a job as an elementary school teacher or middle school, something like that. And she likes him, he likes her, but he is convinced that he's cursed. So he's like holding out and avoiding her. I thought this was kind of ridiculous, particularly the kind of plot hole that comes at the end. It was like very unbelievable, but whatever. It was a free listen technically. And then on to the one book that I have DNF'd this month. That was The Midnight Library by Matt Haig. And I know that this is a super duper popular book, so I was looking forward to this. I think that in the end, the reason that I DNF'd it, and I was mostly listening to this on audiobook, it's just that this book read far too much like a self-help book, and it had the subtlety of a sledgehammer. It just like was throwing all of these sayings at you. It was very much tell, don't show. Also, there is like a suicide trigger warning to this, which I don't know if I knew that. But either way, for that reason, I couldn't keep up with this book. I just DNF'd it. All right, guys, that is the end of my May wrap up. Let me know in the comment section below what your favorite book that you read this month was. And as always, thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.